Hey guys, so right now I'm getting ready to put the tin foil on that's going to line the bed for the river to keep the water from seeping through the diorama. Over top of that I'm going to put the cellular clay and stuff like that, but I put the tin foil on to keep any of the water. The water is thick when I put it on, but it can also be, for some reason, it's quite penetrating. It seems to like to creep everywhere, and it flows through places that you wouldn't expect. So I like to put a bit of tin foil down to keep it from going completely through the diorama and pouring out through the bottom and that kind of thing, and wasting all kinds of material because it drains through like a bathtub. So I put this on, and then I put dams on the ends. If I want to make it so the ends are transparent, so you can see in underneath the water, it's a bit of a gimmick, but you know, if I want to do that, I'll use tape and cover the ends, just masking tape, and it makes it so that you can see through. If not, then I'll just have the edging that I'm going to put on, the foam board, which is over here, this stuff here. It just goes on the side, and it will block off the side of the water anyway. So I haven't decided which I'm going to do yet at the moment. It doesn't make any difference. But the tin foil is for the bottom, so the stuff doesn't flow through, because the plaster wrap and the cellular clay is very porous, so it'll just actually will bleed right through and absorb all of the water that I'm putting on. So the first thing I do is I'm cutting it to shape, because I don't want it everywhere. I don't need it everywhere. So I'm laying it on. Now I'm going to have to overlap it a bit because one sheet isn't quite wide enough, but I don't want it to cover the entire river. So I'm basically just mapping out where it's going to go, and then I will cut it so that trying to message me all at once. Just muting everybody so that I can't get any messages for a little while. There we go. Right, so first thing I want to do is cut the edge on this. Doesn't have to be curvy in any way, shape, or form. Choosing to put the shiny side up because the water that I'm going to be using is two-part resin. It gives off heat, and like I said in the last video, the fellow who recommended the product to me, Ian White, Chalky or CW Modeling, he told me that it only gives off the heat during the mixing process, but I'm paranoid, I guess, so I want to make sure that there's no I guess residual heat, or no mistakes, I guess. So I'm putting the shiny side up so that it will act like, well, it'll dissipate the heat, it'll reflect it up. I don't know if it'll work, but that's kind of what the shiny side's for when you're cooking. It reflects the heat away from what you're trying to cook, like your cooking surface. So that's why I'm using it. So, you know, if it's there, why not use it, right? I don't know if it'll work, but I'm going to use it anyway. touch this. Probably also make mention that it's been almost 24 hours since I put this plaster wrap on, and it's still cool to the touch, which means it's still not completely dry. It's not everywhere. There's a lot of spots that are just kind of room temperature. That's how you can tell that it's not quite ready. That it's it'll always be a little cold to the touch. It's just the nature of plaster, but if it's like feels damp and cold to the touch, then it's not quite right. And there's still a few spots that is like that. I can still work with it like it is, like what I'm doing now, but if I'm going to be putting cellulite clay on it, I want it to be a little bit more dry. So later this afternoon, that's probably when I'll probably do the cellulite clay. But what I'm doing now is I'm going to glue this foil to the surface, and it shouldn't be, it's not going to cause a problem, because as the glue dries, it'll just strengthen the thing anyway. It'll just probably take a little longer if there's any residual moisture, and by a little longer, I mean maybe months. Once the stuff gets trapped, it's quite trapped. So it can be months before it completely dries. But I don't really have the patience to wait for months. Make sure this is going to fit. Right. Set it well. Okay. That's pretty much what I want to do. Glue. The glue I use, this is carpenter's glue. You can use just PVA. PVA will work just fine. I'm only using this because I have a large amount of it, and I trust it. It's pretty strong. So that's why I keep using it. You'll hear my kids in the background because they're home today. And one of them just tried to walk in here while I was talking because they're not paying any attention to what's going on around them like kids usually do. So I shooed them away. They just kind of wander in. Even though they hear me talking, it doesn't occur to them that I'm actually making a video. I've only been doing this for 5 years, and it still doesn't occur to them that when they hear me talking and there's nobody in the room, I'm making a video. They still just kind of wander in and try to talk to me, but that's alright. Normally I would just make a cut and start over again, but when I'm doing this kind of work, it makes it very difficult to do that. Where is my sponge? I need a sponge. This. So for this, you need a somewhat damp sponge so I can spread the glue. Again, it doesn't have to be wonderful. It's mostly the edges that are the most important. I want to get it to the edge. As long as the edges have adhesive, the foil will seal itself down. The rest is just to keep it from shifting and puckering too much. It's never going to have an absolute wonderful, like a perfect connection to the surface below because tinfoil's not very malleable. And if you try to force it, you'll poke holes in it, and that defeats everything that you're trying to do here. So you don't want to do that. Me yelling at my kids. I decided now's a great time to turn the TV on. I explained to them otherwise. Here. You don't want to use too much water when you're doing this, when you're applying it over the plaster, because it'll reactivate it, so use it sparingly. This dry. It's going to take a while, and then when it's done, I'll seal up anything that's sticking up with a little bit of caulking just around the edges and stuff. Trim off anything that's not necessary, and Then I'll get ready for the cellulite clay. That'll be the next thing. So, be back. Hey guys, so I don't remember what I was talking about in the last segment. I think I was talking about sealing the edges of the diorama and adding the borders, but I may not have done that. Basically what I've done, which I didn't show you, was cut some foam board and put it on for like a frame. That wasn't very interesting. I basically just put some foam board, a sheet of foam board on the side, traced out the outline of the diorama, and then took it off and cut it and then glued it on. And then I did it all the way around. Nothing fancy. I made it a little taller than the surface where the plaster wrap is, so that when I put the cellulite clay on, I can like lay it on so it's flat, or it just kind of arcs over to the sides. Because the cellulite clay is going to be, you know, another layer that's going to be on here. I still haven't decided if I'm going to make so that you can see into the river, or it's going to be walled off on the sides. I'll know that when I actually get the cellulite clay on and I know how much room I have to work with. Now, the other thing I did was, which I'll show you in a second, is this. I did the rock wall. The rock wall is very simple. I took some foam board, which is just, you know, it's foam core with like a thick, heavy Bristol board or paper, heavy cardboardy paper, like box board, glued to the outsides. Well, I peel that off on one side, and then I take my stylus, which is this little thing here. It's a basically just a stick of wood with a metal rod going through it, and on either end there's a little ball, a big one and a small one, and I use that literally to draw rocks in it. Right, I just draw unusual shapes all the way across. It took a long time. I did consider using one of my texture rollers from Green Stuff World, but it's the wrong kind of rock, the wrong kind of bricks. They have one, I think, that's more like this, but I don't have it. So, but it's on my to-get list, so I don't have to do that again, because literally that took hours. Using one of these, it takes 5 minutes. Using one of these, it takes 2 hours, 3 hours almost. So, yeah. Either way, I tried to make this rock wall look as close as I could to the photograph that I have off of Google Earth. It's basically a bunch of really jigsaw puzzle looking rocks cobbled together without any mortar that I could see, with some drainage holes offset to each other about halfway up. And then there's a cap layer that goes on here. I can't really see that very well in any of the photographs that I have. So I'm going to have to make it up. It's probably just masonry, a cement layer cap that goes on top. And then that's it. This area here is obscured by cover, so there's probably earth and overgrowth coming down here. This is the ramp made by the engineers right here. Now the river is about half the width that it appears in the photograph. I did some rough guessing, and it's about half of the width. There's just no way I'm going to make this thing the actual perspective that appears in the photograph. The river's just too wide. So it is going to look a little funny when I'm done. Even if I get the camera down nice and low, it would probably be around this area here, aiming this way across the thing. The perspective is going to be a little skewed because the river is only about half the width that it should be. When the wall and the road over here is the right size, and the bank over here will be the right size, and the vehicles will be the right size, but the river is not. So it'll be one massive grievous error, but it's one I had to make in order to be able to build the thing and have it in my cave. So I kind of knew that was going to happen right from the beginning. I did a couple of different test fits using a kitchen table, spacing the vehicles out to try and get the correct perspective distance, and it was enormous. So it would have been nearly 2 meters deep, like this way, almost just shy of 2 meters, and it's too big. I don't have anywhere to put anything like that, but I still wanted to do the thing, so because I'm crazy, I went ahead with it anyway. So the next thing to do right now is I have to paint the rock wall before I do the cellulite clay. So the rock wall will get primed, and then it'll get its base coat, And then that's basically all I have to do. And it's all pretty much monotone. It's all made out of the same stone. There's no irregular stones in it. They're all this kind of a, looks like either slate or shale maybe. I'm not really sure. It's a kind of a bluish gray stone throughout. So I don't really have to go crazy on the tones. I'll do a little bit, but it'll be after it's, I get the cellular clay on and everything like that. I'll do that kind of paint, and then I'll weather it and stuff like that. But I want to get it primed and then base coated, and then put the cellular clay on, because I don't want to paint with the cellular clay on, because I don't want to get, I want, the cellular clay is going to be colored as close to the final color of the earth that I want to, because I don't have to paint all of it, because it's too much of it. If I mix the color up into the cellular clay, it saves me time and it saves me materials, because the stuff that I use to mix into the cellular clay is cheap, and I can get it at the local craft store, or, but it doesn't spray very well, and it doesn't brush on cellular clay very well. But if I mix it in and stir it all together and just color the cellular clay that way, it's actually a lot easier and uses less paint. So if I pre-paint the rock wall and then put the cellular clay on when it's pre-colored, I don't have to spray this and then try and match up the cellular clay later. So that's why I'm going to do that. I have to also sort out some rocks and stuff, because the engineers had moved the, there were like scattered boulders throughout the river. They moved them out of the way and they moved them upstream, up here. So I'm going to have to put a few of those on, then I'll put a few in here, because they obviously didn't move any down here. that sort of thing. And then I have to see about building. There is only going to be one building, and it's going to be here, now that I'm looking at the... everything that will be encompassed in the scene. The building that sits over on this side here won't make it in, because it's actually off the side. There's a, in the photograph, there's a big clump of figures standing here, which won't make it into the diorama, because, well, there's no room to put them. There is a bunch of figures standing here in this area. Those guys will make it in. And then there's, I think, one or two standing along the top of the wall here, and then there's the 6x6 standing here. Actually, the 6x6 is right about here, and then there's another one that's right about here, but I'm not going to buy another 6x6 truck and then cut it in half and put it on there. I'm just not going to do that. And there's also an Easy 8 that's coming in just behind one of the buildings. It's off the shot here, just off in the corner, and that's not going to make it into the scene as well. So now I've finalized exactly what it is I need. I need another... I've already ordered all the crew for the vehicles that I need. They're already on their way. It cost me about $100. And what I need now is just a couple of infantry type figures, or engineers type figures. Figures in, I guess, plain uniforms without like harnesses or rigs and stuff like that. Standing around, basically. Just standing around. Now, luckily, lots of figure manufacturers make figures that are due to just that, so it shouldn't be too hard to find those. But I haven't looked for them yet, so that's the next thing to look for. I'll probably shop for them next week, more than likely, but not today. So, what I'm going to do today, because I've already talked about it long enough, is paint this, and then once that's dry, I'll add the cellular clay. So, painting this is nothing. I just basically grab my airbrush and spray some primer on, wait about 20 minutes, and paint it gray. So I'll do that and then come back. All right, so that's the wall painted there. It's in its, well, it's not its final color, but it's, that's the base coat for it. It's kind of a uniform gray. There's a little tiny bit of, I guess, variance in color. Mostly it's just from the thickness of the primer, but that's about it. And I'm doing kind of a final placement of vehicles before I do the cellular clay and start whipping that up. I'm going to need a fair amount. Most likely one large batch, or maybe two. Definitely one large batch. Now, the angles that the vehicles are sitting here will actually not be quite as extreme as they appear now. And if you look at the photo, they're sitting a bit more flat. The EZ8 is a little bit more level. The Jeep, well, the Beep is almost dead flat. And the jumbo in the background is it's sitting at quite an angle. You can see quite a lot of the front plate as well as the top deck, but not as much as you can here. Now, when I put the cellulite on, it will level out quite a bit. It'll be more along that angle there when I'm done with it. And the truck, I've got the frame built for the truck, well, most of the frame anyway, so it gives me an idea of pretty much the size of it, and that's it there, right? I can't get both of them in there, there's not enough room there, but it's quite a large vehicle, and it will pretty much take up the entire roadway surface that'll be constructed there. And part of this building here will appear right on the back wall there. I'm not going to be able to get this in because it'll be off the side of the diorama there. So, and this clump of fellows that are standing here won't be there, but the guys that are standing here, right there, they'll appear, and there's a fellow standing next to the truck right there, and that's about it. There's also a kind of a fence sort of idea along the top of the wall here. It's mostly just a couple of like footings, concrete footings with what looks like maybe a 4x4 or an 8x8 embedded in it, with a top rail going across the top. It's like a guardrail sort of thing that runs right along there. You can see it bisecting the silhouettes of the trucks and stuff like that, and the figures that are standing here. So I'll build probably maybe 40% of this building here. It'll be running from the corner to about here, and the diorama cuts off right around here. So, and it will be more of a wider angle coming this way from the scene, right? So these rocks will be in here, but these figures will be cut off. I think that's about it. At first I thought this mark right here along this rock wall was like a berm or a bank, part of the bank or anything, but under closer inspection it's actually like a high water mark, just a stain on the wall. So I thought that it might have been like a shoal or a bump or something along here, but it's actually just a high water mark. It's actually just a stain on the rock wall. The rock wall is quite wet, right? So it looks like it was quite a rainy day. So like the top of deck of the EZ8 and the Beep and the Jumbo are wet and stuff like that. So I added some wet effects to the Jumbo. I haven't added any to the Jumbo yet, but the EZ8 has had some, and I haven't added any to the Beep as yet. I think that's it. I haven't added any of the placement weathering to the Beep as well either. So, and I've only added a little bit to the Jumbo. It's mostly just a little bit of wet effects. Just basically, I put gloss paint on it to emulate where water is. And I think I might have put some like a mud color on there, but I didn't put any mud effects on there. Not yet, anyway. This entire passage is a very muddy track, so all the vehicles have mud on them. The EZ8 has quite a lot of mud caked into the running gear, which I've done. There's quite a bit of mud caked into the running gear. You won't be able to see it on here, but the photos that I posted on one of the other videos, you'll be able to see it. So, I think that's about it. There's a fair amount of dead foliage along here, but it's fairly open, and some tall grasses and bushes along this area here, more like alder bushes and stuff like that along this area here, and the rest is mostly mud and turned soil. So it'll be like, it's because it's it's May 1945, but it's like the first week of May, so it's everything's still starting to come to life. And the winter of 45 wasn't exactly a pleasant one, so I think that the spring was a little bit late in coming. At least a lot of the photos that I've seen, I haven't seen a lot of Austria during that period, So I'm not exactly sure how green things were getting, but this doesn't look like there's a lot of life coming in there. That looks like a lot of bushes that haven't started spreading leaves, and there's going to be, I'll have some green in there, right? But I'm probably going to have a lot of mid-spring type colors. So a lot of blondes and browns and stuff like that. So a lot of mud too. I don't know what this road surface is. By the looks of it, it looked like a well-maintained road surface, but it was a bit muddy. The wheels on the 6x6 look quite muddy, like dried mud though. Looks like there's quite a bit of dried mud on them. So this road surface here may have been fairly firm. So I'll probably have this as like a gravel road, but one that has a few ruts in it from a large amount of, an entire armored division is flowing through here. So it's got quite a bit of traffic. So enough blathering, more talking than doing in this. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to mix up the cellulite clay. That's going to take me a few minutes, and then I'm basically going to start blobbing it on. So the first thing I have to do is spread glue, PVA, just white PVA, on all the areas I'm going to be putting the cellulite clay. It's actually, from the looks of it, the cellulite clay is going to go everywhere that you see that's white on here. Then it'll be a week, probably, before I'm able to do anything after that, because I have to wait for the cellulite clay to harden. And cellulite clay takes about a week, depending on how thick it is. It could be 3 days, it could be 5 days, I'm not really sure. It's up to the cellulite clay, to be honest. So anyway, I'll get that together and then we'll go from there. Okay, so I'm going to do the cellulite clay now. Basically, I take just plain PVA glue and I spread it everywhere I'm going to put the cellulite clay. And the purpose of the PVA glue is to add strength to the bond. There's already PVA mixed in with the cellulite clay. That's part of how it works. It's basically just paper mache made with PVA, but when you add the PVA like this, it just makes it even stronger. Now the white glue starts to dry in about 15 minutes, so don't go beyond where you're going to be working, because if you do, it'll be dry. Now I'm just taking a piece of tissue paper and I'm using it as a blotter to spread the PVA around. And it coats the whole surface. Doesn't have to be perfect. Putting the PVA on like this is it does aid in preventing rolling up the diorama. As cellulite clay dries, the water evaporates obviously, and when it does, the PVA shrinks a bit, and in large thick sheets it will curl, and as it does, it will pull your diorama with it, or it will pull itself free of the diorama. If you've got a good solid base and you use the PVA glue to hold the cellulite clay to the surface, as it dries, it doesn't do anything. It just dries. Sometimes you'll get a few cracks here and there, which you fill with a little bit extra cellulite clay later once it dries. So if you have a good solid base like plywood is extremely strong, it won't curl because the PVA holds the cellulite clay to the surface. If it's not good, what will happen is either the base will curl with the cellulite clay, or the cellulite clay will break free of the base and curl up on itself. So these are things you want to avoid if you can. So you don't want to have layers of cellulite clay thicker than 1 centimeter. I try to keep it a little less than 1 centimeter, just for safety margins. And if you want to go deeper than 1 centimeter, do it in layers. Layers are your friend. It dries faster when it's in thinner layers. 1 centimeter usually takes about 2 days, maybe 3, to dry, whereas half a centimeter can dry in 1, depending on the humidity as well. Humidity has quite an effect. If there's a lot of humidity where you live, it'll take a lot longer for it to dry. Right now where I am, it's still early spring, and so we get a lot of rain right now, and so it's quite humid and wet. So the cellulite clay is probably going to take a little while for it to dry, which is good because when it dries slow, it tends to curl less, it tends to shrink less. Now, with cellulite clay, you have a good 5 hours of work time. So you can work with it for like 5 hours or so before it starts to get to the point where it resists and it's annoying to work with. But you can work with it even beyond that. So there is no hurry whatsoever. You don't have to stress out or panic or anything about rushing or anything. The only thing that you need to be concerned about is the PVA that you laid down. You want to get the cellulite clay on before that PVA dries. So that would be the only time factor that you want. So going in small sections alleviates that. But if the PVA dries, just add more, and then keep going. Now I've added more PVA than I could probably. I'm going to have to make another batch or two or possibly even three of the cellulite clay before I get all this covered. And so the PVA will have long dried by then, so I'll have to add more. But it was more for demonstration purposes. I wanted to show how I applied it. So as I'm doing now, just wanted to show you how I apply the cellulite clay. I've done this in many videos anyway, so, I mean, this is, hopefully, it shouldn't be too revolutionary to you. You should have seen me do this before. So what I'm doing now is I'm basically spreading a primary layer. I'm putting on, it's basically like a subsurface. So I put this on, and I will cover the entire diorama with it. And since it has such an incredibly long work time, I can do whatever I want with it. Over the course of several hours, I use basically this and maybe a couple other small sculpting tools for sculpting, like just regular clay, like sculpting clay, to add different things to the surface and shape it in the details that I want. So adding ditches, small hills, mounds, bumps, deformities. Like in the photograph, right next to the EZ8, there's a big chunk of upturned sod where it looks like a bulldozer had plowed through there and dumped a big chunk next to the thing. So that would be something I want to add. But it's not something I want to add right now. Right now I'm just doing the contoured surface. So this is all just the preliminary. It's all just contours I'm adding. And then over top of that, I'll add smaller details. I can either add it now, or I can add them much later after this, the primary coat is even dry. Now, the problem with that though is I won't be able to add like recesses. If I wanted to add a ditch or something like that, it would be very difficult to add once the cellulite clay is dry, because the cellulite clay is very, very hard when it dries. So it's not an easy thing. You can. It's difficult to add furrows and stuff like that to it once it's hardened. So it would be a good idea to do it now. If you're going to be adding ditches or troughs or trenches or whatever, now is the time to add it. Otherwise, it'll be... I don't even know how you would do it, to be honest, if you're going to add them later. It would be very difficult. You would need sharp tools. maybe a chisel. I kid you not, cellulite clay is pretty hard, especially when it's thick. It's quite strong, and it's sandable. You can sand it, and you can shape it a bit, but it'll come apart in pieces. Like, it's not a very controllable surface once it's hard. So you should do most of your work when it's still soft. And you can still work on it like 8 hours after you've laid it, so it's just a bit more firm. It is pretty much my favorite material for doing groundwork, though, because it's really light, it's fairly inexpensive, it goes for a really long way, and you can color it, you can shape it so easily, it's non-toxic, it doesn't stink. It doesn't have any bugs in it, so it's very versatile, so I value it quite highly. That's why I use it so much. And I'm not the only one. This stuff's been in use for, not just by me, by other modelers and stuff like that for a really long time. So, I mean, there's a reason why I use this, because I've seen lots of other guys using it. And they write books and stuff, so... Figured there's a chance they might know a bit more about it than I do. I've said this many times in other videos. Nothing you see me doing is original. I don't make this stuff up. This is not mine. None of these are my ideas. All this stuff came from books that I've studied over years. So I'm stealing quite liberally from greater builders than me. I just watched what they did and imitated it to the best of my ability. But that's kind of the point. That's what the books are for. So. Alright. So that's basically what you see me doing now is what I'm going to be doing for the next probably 40 minutes or so. So I'm going to keep carrying on with this until I get all the way across. And then I'm going to come back and I'll show you what I do for the... Once the contour coat is on, I'll come back and do the detail, the fine stuff. So where I'll be shaping roadways, I'll be shaping the turned over stuff, and shaping the riverbed a bit, and then I'll start adding details like rocks and gravel and terrain and stuff. Right, so this is the it's all covered with the cellulite clay now, and like I said, this is the contour coat. All it is the basic shape, and what I'm going to do now is add variances to it, so it's not so smooth and boring looking. I don't need to add much, because there isn't much. what most of it will be is upturned mud from where the vehicle passed. The vehicles passed by. And where the engineers created the ramp for the tanks to travel up and down. I think mostly down was their focus. And it was quite churned up and messy looking. First, and in that I can add stakes and roots, that sort of thing, make it look like it's churned earth. So the easy aid is going to go here. Easy aid was sitting on prepared surface of boards. That was the ramp that was constructed by the engineers so that the vehicles could get out of the river easily without getting stuck and bogged down and sinking into the surface. And there's a large upturned clump of roots right next to where the tanks had passed, which is what this is going to represent. It's going to be there. And then there was a vehicle track where something had passed earlier on. Not sure what it was. It's probably another tank. It passed through and squashed the surface quite heartily. So it's pretty churned up. And come through here. Now I'll construct the board surface out of cocktail sticks and coffee stirrers and that sort of thing. I don't know what's under the water where the vehicles pass, but there's a fence constructed to mark out where the vehicles are required to drive. I have to stay between the guideposts. I don't know if the engineers prepared the river surface or not. My guess is they didn't. It would be probably kind of difficult with the current and all. But I'm going to add a churn surface to the under where the river will be, make it look like someone had at least churned it up anyway. Now the surface where the tanks had traveled down over here was unprepared by boards, so the vehicles had passed down and just made furrows, messy furrows in the mud, in the soil. It's quite messy. This is going to be pretty churned up as well. What the hell that was? The sun's playing with something out there. So the easy aid is going to be sitting here. And this is going to be the prepared surface that the wooden bridge. Well, it's not so much of a bridge as a bunch of boards lying on the ground. The tank dries over. It'll be here. Okay, so, there's a bit too much smooth surface, so natural looking around the area, so I'm going to add just some hills and bumps, give a little bit of a irregularity, make things look a bit more interesting. I needed that. A blob of cyanocobalt went flying across the room and I had to go get it. That's all I got in there for the cellular clay. If you're wondering how many batches of cellular clay, in other words, this thing full, took four to cover this thing. That's a lot. It's probably going to take 10 days for this thing to dry. That's a lot. So, but what I need to do now that this is set up like this, I need to build the little bridge that goes here. I need to build the building that goes here in the back, and I need to build the fence posts that go along the guardrail here. Those I can just stick on there. They don't need to be embedded in the surface. My concern is things that need to be embedded into the surface or need to make marks in the surface. So rocks, boulders, tank tracks, vehicle tracks, embedded fences, that sort of thing. Those are the things I need to work on now. So I've got about 8 hours before this is going to be too hard to work on anymore. So I'm going to collect that stuff. I already have most of it all set up and stuff like that. So I'll put that together and then we'll come back for that. And that'll be probably the end of it for this video, I think. All right. So I'm going to do the wooden bits that are going to go here for the bridge that goes under the Easy 8 last. And the fence that goes along here, the guardrail that goes along here, I'll do that. And the marker posts that go along the river and stuff like that, I'll also do them last. They're literally just pieces of square post that get stuck in the mud here. And this is just literally a bunch of cocktail sticks, or popsicle sticks that I'm going to cut the length and embed in here. And then let it dry and then pry them up and glue them on later. So right now I'm going to do some beach stones. These are just literally pebbles that my daughter collected at the local beach or the local playground and then brought them home. So actually I have some more of them out in the garage. I should probably go get them and come right back. Alright, okay, I got my rocks. Now these rocks I'm going to embed in the surface here, but they're going to get painted to the color that I'm going to choose later on, which is going to be probably very close to the color of the rock wall. And the ones I'll do first are the ones that I want to use to emulate the rocks that were moved aside by the engineers when they cleared the riverbed for the passage of the vehicles. So I want to have a fair number of them. Try not to get these in here too regularly. I want them to look regular or pattern. Sizes. There's a fairly rock-strewn, I don't know if it's a river or a stream or what you want to call it. I'd call it a small river myself, but there were quite a few rocks in it. In the photo. Hoping it will look something like it does in the photo anyway. Well, it's more going to be representative than it will be accurate anyway. Because I don't have the exact rocks that were in the photo. probably do it. Alright. Next thing I'm going to add, smaller ones. This is gravel, pressure dust it's called. It's something that I hate. Just outside my house here, I have a series of pathways that I built around my house, and this is what it's made out of. It's just basically crushed, I think it's shale. Now this is gravel, it's just medium ballast. I wish I had a darker one, but I don't. And this I'm going to use for the road surface. That was the, where the trucks passed. Up here. This is going to be a gravel road. I know the jug comes with a shaker in it, but I don't like the way it disperses. It's mixed lines. I don't like the lines. This is meant to represent gravel for a gravel road surface. I have a few different sizes and densities of this stuff, but unfortunately it's too light and I don't like the color, so I'm not going to use it. Tamp it down. A lot of this is going to get oversprayed with thin PVA anyway, and eventually hairspray and matte photo mount and a couple of probably it for adhesives. So it'll end up getting glued down that way. But I like to tamp it into the surface as well. Gives it that compacted look. I want it to look like a fairly hardened road surface. Now the surface of this diorama is still really, really, really soft. So that's why I'm not spraying adhesive on right now. Wouldn't make any difference. It'll just soak in. And in the end, it wouldn't make any difference. I'll wait for it to dry. And then overspray it. After it's dried out. Sam. Yeah, you can come back later. I love it when they do that. Alright. So that'll do for the road surface, I think. Now the next thing I'm going to add is this. This is basically pulverized crusher dust. This also comes from my yard. It's basically what's in my garden, all around my gardens and stuff like that. This is like the very bottom. Once I clear away the larger particles and stuff like that, this is what's at the bottom. So I'm going to take this. Actually, I don't only have a moment or two left on this camera, so I'll just briefly show you. I sprinkle that around. And it gives a nice earthy color, nice earthy surface. And then I will spray this with thin PVA to tap it down once it's hardened, once all the cellulose clay is hardened. And anywhere where there's not road surface, I put this stuff, including where the riverbed goes. So I'm going to keep doing this. And then I'll come back in the next part and I'll show you basically what it looks like. Right, so this is now with all the bark mulch, the pulverized bark mulch everywhere that you saw me doing. And I've managed to get it everywhere I wanted it to now. Now when I put the water on, it's going to go through this area here. Keep knocking that over. It's going to go through this area here. And it'll incorporate the area that has the bark mulch and everything, but it'll be wet, of course. the banks along the river will have grass on it, as well as probably some low ground cover, like maybe bank vines or like leafy vines and some shrubs and bushes and stuff like that. There are a couple of trees that have to go here that have no leaves on it. There's like, it looks like tall, really tall grass, but I'm pretty sure it's like a funny looking shrub. That's right, can't see it too well in this picture, but right here and right here behind the tank, there's these big fan-like, looks like really tall grass, but it's some kind of shrub or with really straight branches behind it. There's more of it over here on this side. So I have to put that in there. So the vegetation's gonna go in there. I'm gonna have some grass up along the bank here and stuff. So while I was off camera here, I managed to build the it's basically like an anti-ditching type feature that the tanks use to climb up on a soft bank to keep the tank from digging into the bank and getting stuck. It works like an anti-ditching log kind of thing. Basically, it just disperses the weight, distributes it over a wider surface so the tank doesn't sink, so it can climb up onto the bank. So I built that. It's going to get much more elaborate once I'm done. This is just so I can impress it into the surface, so it creates like a mold of itself. When it's dry, I'll pop it out, paint it, and then weather it, and it'll go back in. I'm probably going to add more boards on top of it, so it looks more like the photograph. These are just cocktail sticks that are blunt on both ends. They're supposed to be square in the photograph, and I may still yet replace them with square pieces. I don't have that many square pieces, so that's why I didn't do them. And these are just pieces of square dowel for the guardrail up here, and I just cut them in length and sanded them down. I'll coat them with Mr. Surfacer once the groundwork is dry to make them look like concrete, and then I put a couple of cocktail or coffee stirrers on top to give it to make it look like the guardrail. I still have yet to build the building in the back for the facade. It's just going to be the front of the building. It's like a shed, plank shed. But that's probably going to be over the next while. This thing's going to take about a week or so to dry, so while that's drying, that's what I'll be working on. I still have to build the 6x6, which is sitting over there off camera. I need to consider what kind of vegetation I'm going to do. I recently found another photograph of this scene that's been colorized, and whoever did that colorization used a slightly different scheme for color. The date on that one, it was a different date than the last photos. All the photos that I found so far are for, say, that this scene is depicting the 11th Armored Division crossing the Mule River. I still don't have that written down in front of me. Crossing the river in Austria in May of 1945, like the first week of May in 1945. I think it's in May 4th or May 6th or something like that. But this new version of the photograph I found said it's like May 9th or April 9th, 1945, which kind of changes the colors a bit. That's like early spring. So there would be less green and more like dead winter kill off type colors and stuff like that. Whereas in May, that's much further into the spring, so there'd be a lot more green with potential flowers and stuff like that growing, and that it changes everything. So I mean, there's a couple of trees right here that have no leaves, and then there's a couple of really tall, they're like bushes with really long straight branches right here and right here, and they have no leaves on them either. So I'm not really sure if May is correct. I don't live in Europe, so I don't know how fast everything comes back to life. A friend of mine, you know, he's showing me pictures of the area he lives in and stuff like that, and it blooms up pretty quick. So I think in May, it'd be quite lush in Austria. So I think maybe the April date is probably more correct, considering the foliage you can actually see in the photograph, the black and white photograph. I can't trust the colorized ones because, well, they're colorized, and it's people guessing at what they see as seeing colors. Now, mind you, the colors on the tanks in the second colorized photo are more, I think they're more accurate. Not entirely, but they're closer. But the colors for the vegetation and stuff like that, I'm not totally sold on. So, I might go with the earlier spring color set, so there's more winter kill-off, fallish type colors, a little bit less green. There'll be some, but not tons of it. So, but we'll see what happens. I have to confirm the dates. I have to find a way to confirm the dates. Not a lot of information on the photograph. Just a couple of blurbs in a couple of spots is all I found so far. So it'll be difficult to do that. Yeah. So anyway, so like I said, I got to wait for about a week or so for this thing to dry, and I got a bunch of things that I need to do. So don't expect another video on this for a while. I've got a pretty definite plan on what it is I'm going to do with a lot of this. So hopefully it'll all come together when I'm done with it. So we'll see what happens. Anyway, till then, you guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.